your prodigal preacher has returned. We had a real good time. I was going to start saying Jambo Habariyaku, and I thought, well, I'm in America now, so I won't do that to you. Sue might respond to me. We had a wonderful time, and so grateful to get to go. Seeing my wife was like a kid in a candy shop, as every Kenyan she came up to, she'd launch into her Swahili and just chat it up, and I'd sit there twiddling my thumbs because I didn't know what they were saying. But it didn't matter. She had a wonderful time. I guess most of you probably seen our pictures. It was amazing. We had a bull elephant just as close as that second pew, close enough to where the driver would keep backing up because the elephant would kind of move towards us. And so he'd back up to make sure we weren't too close because they can decide they don't like the looks of you. And I asked him if he'd ever been charged. And he said, yes, some rhinoceros had actually charged his Jeep. So you do have to be careful. They're wild animals. But it was a great time. We're so appreciative to get to go and to do that. And we spent some time with Jacobo and Mama Grace. You saw the picture of probably a Mama Grace with Sue. They're 91 and 90. And they helped in the home when Sue was a little girl. And Mama Grace remembered her. Jacobo's starting to lose his memory. And then we stayed with her high school roommate, which that was a lot of fun. So we just had a great time. And good to go, good to be back. I was about ready to kiss the soil when I got back. We were 24 hours in the plane with layovers and everything. So it was good to get back on solid ground. But thank you for understanding, letting us do that. It was wonderful. And now we're here. We got some things going on. We got, of course, the regular Tuesday morning Bible study with Revelation. We got Team Kid. This Wednesday is our last night of the school year for Team Kid. We're going to have a special night. Grill some hot dogs for them, tube steaks. We'll dress it up a little bit. We're going to grill tube steaks and celebrate the end and talk about that. And then next Sunday is our building rededication service, and I'm going to save some time at the end of the service to let you know my crazy wild-haired plans for that, but it's going to be a big day. We've already got some guests coming to be with us. You're going to love it, so I'll share more about that later. Right now, I want to encourage you, thinking ahead to Memorial Day. I've had several questions. You can put down and anybody you want to, as far as a veteran who is deceased, that we want to memorialize on Memorial Day. It doesn't have to be a church member. There's no limit to how many. We want to take time to honor and recognize those who have served our country. And so I invite you to fill this out. If you need more space, get another one right on the back. But tell us what you can about them. If you know their rank, if you know their branch, where they served, we will print up a list. Susan will print up a list to include in the bulletin next week with their information. We will call their names out, give you a chance to stand in their honor and recognize them. And one other thing that I'm going to do is I have gotten miniature American flags, and one flag will be put out for each person you mention. And at the end of the service, you'll be able to take that flag home with you to do what you want. If you want to take it to the graveyard, or if you want to just have it at home to remember them by. So we're going to take a special time to remember those who have served our country. And we need your help by completing that form and doing that for us. Let's have a word of prayer, and then we'll get into our worship time. Dear precious Father, we thank you so much. You are a great and loving God. Lord, we just don't know how good you are to us. We don't know the times that you protected us, that you've seen us through, that you've caused a wayward car to go a different direction. You've delayed us. You watch over us, Lord. You provide for us. You care about us. You know about us. You know our name. I thank you that we have a personal God who loves us, who is concerned with how many hairs are on our head, who is concerned with our problems. So we give you all glory, praise, and honor today. Lord, we have several in our midst that are struggling with health issues, and we want to lift them up, asking your presence with them. Some are nearing time to go on to glory, and so we ask your presence with them and their family. We have others who are just recuperating. But Father, we love and miss each and every one, and we know that you care about them, so we, in our hearts, we lift up our names to you, their names to you, so that we mention them. You're already aware. Father, we do ask that you'd be with our worship service this morning, that you would fill this room, that each and every person would know they've been in the presence of Almighty God. We love you, Lord. Thank you for loving us, and it's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Let's sing.
Our first song this morning is I Build My Life on You. Would you stand and sing with me, please?
A cave around me. I think about the way your love and grace and peace have found me. I remember what you said, you will never ever leave me. So I'm holding on to all your promises.
Song this morning is He Keeps Me Singing. This is hymn 425. Song this morning. This is hymn 10. This is How Great Thou Art.
Trying to think of something funny to tell you all about, and really the funniest thing might be on May 1st, I think it was May 1st, maybe it was April 24th, that evening, I had gotten a notice in the email that there was a problem with the streaming software we use to put our program out on Facebook. So I had logged in from my motel in Nairobi and was working on it, and Alexa walked in while I was doing that and got freaked out because the computer's doing all this stuff, changing scenes, and nobody was sitting at it. So she finally said, are you online? Because I think we were texting. I said, yeah. And I explained to her there was a problem that I was fixing remotely from Nairobi. It's amazing what you can do with the computers and stuff. But I spied on you. I could see, and I was watching people come in and watched you come into the building a little bit, and then we watched the service. But all of that partly is just because missed you, missed being in the building and wanted to look in and see what was happening. And it was good to see. And y'all had some low days, but you had a good Mother's Day, didn't you? A lot of people showing up and good times. So it's good and blessed my heart to see those things. We are in Acts chapter 2. Verses 42 through 47 specifically. And the sermon today is coming from my heart being blessed. And I wanted to share as sort of an encouragement and as an encouragement to keep going. Here in the book of Acts, it starts out in chapter 1 with Jesus' ascension. And it shows kind of the mindset that people had, because there when he's with them, the disciples said, well, Jesus, are you now going to establish the kingdom? That's what was on their mind, is they were thinking, get rid of the Romans, get things back in order. And Jesus told them, said, it's not for you to know the seasons, but the Holy Spirit is going to come upon you and then fill you and empower you to go to Judea, Samaria, and the uttermost parts of the earth. And it shows us where Jesus' mind was. The people were concerned about getting loose from the Roman Empire, from the domination. Jesus, true to his nature, focus was on reaching people for Christ. And he had told them in John chapter 14, I must go. He was giving them a preview. He said, I must go, but if I go, I will send a comforter, and he will show you things that you do not know, and you will do greater things than I have done. And so Jesus in Acts chapter 1 repeats that, essentially saying, I'm about to ascend, but the Holy Spirit will come, the third part of the triune God, God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit. And it is that Holy Spirit that indwells each and every believer, empowering us to do the things of Christ. But I was just struck by that dichotomy, if you will, that the disciples were still thinking in earthly terms about political domination, and Jesus is thinking about his mission of people being reached for Christ. He ascends into the air. And the people are there in Rome, or Jerusalem rather, and Peter starts preaching to them a rather direct sermon about how they crucified the Son of God and how they murdered him. And it convicted the people. And we have that verse where about 3,000 were saved and baptized on that day, a vast movement. And we read about how the Holy Spirit descended, and it looked as cloven tongues, and the people could hear the gospel in their own language. And so God is starting that work in Acts, and people are amazed and thrilled with what's happening. And we pick it up in verse 42 of chapter 2, the words will be on the screen. They devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching and to the fellowship, to the breaking of bread, and to prayer. Everyone was filled with awe, and many wonders and miraculous signs were done by the apostles. All the believers were together and had everything in common. selling their possessions and goods they gave to anyone as he had need. Every day they continued to meet together in the temple courts. They broke bread in their homes and ate together with glad and sincere hearts, praising God and enjoying the favor of all the people. And the Lord added to their number daily those who were being saved. Sounds like a glorious time in that early church. A time of unity, a time of joy, a time of worshiping together. And as we break down these verses and look at it, again, looking back in verse 42, they devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching. At that time, they had Old Testament scriptures, but of course the New Testament had not been written or codified yet. That didn't come for many years later. But they had first-hand accounts. If you could imagine sitting under Matthew and Mark and John and Peter and hearing them tell the stories about being with Jesus and what Jesus taught and getting that firsthand, that's such a glorious experience, and that's what they're doing here. They're listening to the apostles' teaching, and it's news to them. It's fresh. It's invigorating. The Jewish faith had become a faith of a lot of rules, a lot of laws, a lot of burdensome and oppressive. And here Jesus' teaching comes along, and it's so fresh about loving your neighbor and loving your enemy and caring for others, and they take that to heart. And so they're listening to this teaching and to the fellowship, to the breaking of bread. People don't change. We enjoy sitting around having a meal with each other. They did back then. They would have times together. They ate together. They enjoyed that. You know, we are social creatures. We enjoy the company of each other. Yes, we get alone for a while. Sometimes we get alone too much as different circumstances. COVID isolated us. We quarantined. We weren't able to be with our friends. And children really suffered by not being able to have that experience. My granddaughter, Reagan, really struggled with that. She needs that interaction, and she was divorced from it. We as humans need that social interaction, and it really ascribes to it there in Hebrew 9:27, where the author wrote, "Forsake not the assembling of yourselves together, as the habit of some is, but continue meeting." We need to meet in a corporate setting. All of us who know God know that we can worship Him on the lake fishing. We can worship Him out under the tree. We can worship Him when we're on the tractor, plowing on the farm. Wherever we are, we can worship God within ourselves and rejoice in His creation. But there's something powerful when we come together as God's people. We lift up our voices in song as we've done today. We greet each other. Some walked in today and said, "Welcome, Pastor, give me a hug." We enjoy that contact, and so we need that, and that's what they were doing here. They were breaking bread together. They were having fellowship, and then they were praying. We so often tend to make prayer just so much more of a burden, of an exercise, than it needs to be, because it's strictly just talking to God, as much as we would talk to each other. And He just wants us to share with Him about our day. We don't have to be, "O Thou Heavenly Father, Thou knowest all things, and Thou lookest down upon us." That's a stilted prayer, and God's probably yawning about it. He just wants you to talk to Him like His child, to say, "God, I just amazed at the flowers and the trees that You've done, and Your creation, Lord, and I just enjoy it so much." Or, "Lord, I was struggling so much today. My heart is heavy. A friend is sick. My mom or dad is getting weaker or frail." just pouring out your heart as a child does to a parent, to just unabashed conversation is what prayer is about. It doesn't have to be this real convoluted thing. And then, of course, being quiet and letting God speak to you. I have to remember to do that when I have my quiet time in the morning. I'm like everybody. I have my laundry list of things I want to go over. I have my pattern. I use ACTS, the acronym, to guide my prayer: adoration, confession, thanksgiving, supplication. And I make my request known to God, but then I try to be sure, quieten myself, and give Him a chance to talk. You ever had those friends where you can't get a word in edgewise and you want to share? Here we all have. Well, God wants to get a word in edgewise. And so be sure when you're praying to just take that time to listen. And sometimes I fall asleep, I'll confess. And I used to let that bother me. But then I realized there's nothing sweeter than falling asleep, communing with my God, and Him speaking to my heart and talking to me. And I wake up refreshed and strengthened. So they were doing this. They were gathering themselves in prayer. It says everyone was filled with awe, wonders and miraculous signs that the apostles were doing. They were filled with the Holy Spirit. God had imbued them with that power. And in their faith, they believed and they were healing. They were doing miraculous signs, and it was, of course, impressive. The people hadn't seen this before. Verse 44, all the believers were together and had everything in common. There was unity. Oh, if we could all just get along and see. And we can. You know, when you stop to think about it, how can we have unity? How can we have one mind? Because we're different people, we have different experiences. Tom and I were talking earlier about Memorial Day and the experiences of World War II. Those of you who lived back then, Tom was sharing with me how every town had a board and had names on it, and if there was a black star, it meant it was a fallen soldier, and you didn't want to see any black stars, and how that was a daily event that the towns, every town, went through. I haven't experienced that. I haven't experienced being in the military. I don't know that lifestyle. A lot of you do. So we have different experiences, and it molds us and it shapes us and it has us look at things in different ways. And so it's natural that we would have some diversity there, that we would have some differences in how we view things. But in the church, we can have unity when all of us are looking to Jesus Christ. As we all look up to Him, as we all seek to emulate Him, He takes us from each of our disparate upbringings, experiences, and as we're all moving to Him, we are all moving together. And so that's what they were doing, and that's what we want to do. If we can get that mindset of setting Wes aside, of setting James aside, of setting Bob aside, and looking towards Christ, we're going to become of one like mind. And as we seek His desires, as we seek what He wants, His missions, we're going to seek the same thing because He is one God. And God will use those differences, those diversities within us to accomplish His task, because something I may not think about, you may, because of your varied experiences, because of the training you've received. And together we can accomplish His mission because it's using all facets of everybody. And so they're doing this. They're meeting together. They had everything in common to the point they had a sensitivity to those people who were in want. And it says they were selling their possessions and goods. They were giving of themselves. They were giving of what they had to help those without. And they were helping those who are in need. And it says, goes on to say in verse 46, every day they continued to meet together in the temple courts. Every day. They didn't have a church. They didn't have a building like this to meet and worship in. They may meet in people's homes, but here it was such a citywide phenomenon. It was such a communal thing that they would gather in the courts, which would have been probably the temple courts there. In the Jewish temple, the Jewish worship place, there was one place that was the court of the Gentiles, and that's where the non-Jewish people could gather to worship God or just gather. They weren't allowed into the inner part, the Holy of Holies, unless you were a believing Jew, a practicing Jew. But there was that court of the Gentiles. So that's probably where they would gather to greet each other and talk about what God had done in their lives and to address needs. Every day, it says they did that. We sometimes bemoan getting up one morning a week and coming into church, and we run late, but they, every day, imagine the joy and the energy, and they did that. They broke bread in their homes, again, it repeats that, and ate together with glad and sincere hearts. Oh, such a wonderful experience. Praising God and enjoying the favor of all the people. People saw their ministering to each other. They saw them selling possessions. They saw them meeting the needs of the hungry and the sick. And it in turn reflected upon God. And the people praised God for that and they found favor. And the same holds true with us today. As people see us being unselfish and reaching out to the needs of others, it honors our God and it is attractive to them about our God. And finally in 47, praising God, enjoying the favor of the people, the result of that dedication to God, the result of that focus on Him, God honored it, and the Lord added to their number daily those who were being saved. One of the things that is such a paradigm shift, I'll use a word I used on you some time back, a change of mind, is to get to that place where we understand that if we will quit struggling and vying for those things that we think are important and we go to serve our God, we make Him our focus, we make Him what we want to do in life, and we want to obey Him. Once we put Him first and ourselves on down the line, then God turns around and blesses us with what we need. And He blesses us better than we could ask or think. He has the cattle on 1,000 hills. He has all of the universe. He has all of everything. So who better can give to us that which we need and even what we want? Jesus said that, seek ye first the kingdom of God and His righteousness, and all these things will be added unto you. If we could just get it in our mind to quit trusting ourselves and our strength and trusting Him, and then rejoicing in the benefits and the blessings that He bestows upon us. And that's what we see here in the book of Acts. Now, why did this passage come to mind? Why did I want to speak on this? It's because my heart is full in thinking about our church and what's been going on. And I'm still not over our work day that we had April 9th when 25 or whatever it was showed up to clean up our church and to work on it. We had people all over the sanctuary and all over outside and inside, and we're seeing the blessings from that. The landscaping outside that the guys put down the mulch and continue to water is beautiful as we drive up, and it highlights our church building inside we're not gasping for breath because everything's covered with a layer of dust. We're seeing improvements with the walls. It's going to get pretty soon, we'll forget the holes that were in them, the plaster falling down. And so that's repaired. It's dry inside. We were talking about last night some that, you know, a year ago it was so bad that some people had to quit coming because the mold and mildew was so strong. They couldn't breathe in here. It would flare up their allergies, and they wanted to worship, but they couldn't physically because it was so bad. But that's gone away. It's dried out. We've taken away the dehumidifiers. We've turned them off. God has blessed us. And so my heart is full from that one experience, talking about the work day, but ongoing. I keep hearing, even this morning as I walked in, people sharing, not bragging, not trying to get recognition, but just sharing about how they had taken care of different things around their church to help maintain her, to help keep her looking beautiful. And all of that blesses my heart. And I wanted to thank you for that. And I wanted to bless you and for the work you're doing. And much of it is not seen. And I wish there was a way, you know, as pastor, people share things with me, I observe, I see, and I know of work going on that is unseen to most of you. And these people aren't looking for recognition, they're not looking for a pat on the back, they're acting on behalf of their church because of their love for the church, their love for God, and they want it to be a place of worship. And that just blesses my heart that we are getting that sense of being in one accord, of having things in common. As we come in, there's joy, there's laughter, there's enjoyment in our worship, and we enjoy seeing each other, and we enjoy fellowshipping together. And that is a powerful and a wonderful thing, and I just want that to continue to grow. If you have your Bibles, it won't be on the screen, please turn to Romans chapter 12. We'll look at some other scripture there that the Apostle Paul wrote. And, you know, I did preach there in Africa, and they told me a minimum of an hour. And they were used to 2 hours. I did make it over an hour. But I tell you what, I thought maybe I'll enjoy that and come back and preach that long. It was exhausting. So I'm not going to do that to you. Us soft Americans, you know, the mind can only absorb what the seat can endure. I don't know if you've ever heard that, but we're in Romans chapter 12 real quickly, and then I want to share some things about next week. Starting at verse 3, the Apostle Paul writes, "For by the grace given me, I say to every one of you, do not think of yourself more highly than you ought, but rather think of yourself with sober judgment, and according with the measure of faith God has given you." So just have, you know, we need to have a right attitude about ourselves. And it's real easy for us to think about something we've done and I'm doing this work and nobody else is showing up. We can think that sometimes because they're doing it at a different time that we don't see. So we need to be sure we keep ourselves in a proper check and not think too much of ourselves, and to understand we're working in the faith God has given us. Verse 4, just as each of us has one body with many members, arms, legs, nose, eyes, ears, all of those are members of our body. Just as each of us has one body with many members, and these members do not have the same function. We'd be a mess if we were all arms or all legs or everything was a nose. We need the different functions for us to function as a whole. Just as that is true, so in Christ, we who are many form one body, the body of Christ, and each member belongs to the others. We are all part of this body and rely on each other. Verse 6, we have different gifts according to the grace given us. And then he outlines some. If a man's gift is prophesying, let him use it in proportion of his faith. And let me say there, prophesying in this New Testament term is not foretelling the future. It's not doing that. It's proclaiming the truth. That's what prophesying is in the New Testament terms. Prophesying is proclaiming the truth. So if that is the gift God's given you, then do it according to your faith. If it is serving, let him serve. If it is teaching, let him teach. If it is encouraging, let him encourage. If it is contributing to the needs of others, let him give generously. If it is leadership, let him govern diligently. If it is showing mercy, let him do it cheerfully. I don't have time to go into it today. It's a fantastic study of the gifts of the Spirit. When each person comes to know Christ as Savior, that Holy Spirit not only comes and indwells us, but he gives us a spiritual gift. And that gift can be prophecy, servant, administration, giving, different ones. And God, it tells us later, Paul writes, God distributes those as he desires. Every single Christian in here has been given a gift from God to be used to build up this body and to accomplish the mission of Christ. And it's very helpful to discover that gift. And if you are interested in that and would like to, we can talk sometime and discover that and look at it. But he's saying, Paul is saying here, use your gift to affect the whole body. Not everybody is a teacher. Not everybody has the gift of prophecy. We need people who have the gift of service, of hospitality, to meet the needs of others. We need people. There are people God blesses. I'm not one that have the gift of giving. And in the gift of giving, God blesses that person with the ability to attract money, to make money, not for their own good, but so that they can disperse it to other ministries. So a lot of times, if you've known people that it just seems like whatever they touch turns to gold, they're just successful, that can be the gift of giving that God has given them for the purpose of using it for God's ministry. So Paul is teaching here, use your gift to help the body. And so as we think about all that is being accomplished and the individual work people are doing and trimming hedges and watering the lawn and cleaning inside and out and other preparation and teaching, I had one telling me today about how God's laid on their heart and they are determined to work with these children that we're having on with Team Kid as we move forward. And that is a blessing and a gift. As we use that in order for our body of Christ at Campbellsburg Baptist to accomplish the mission that God has called for this church. Real quickly, I went through a period, a lot of people go through, a lot of young people go through. Why do we have denominations? Why do we have Presbyterians? Why do we have Methodists? Why do we have Baptists, Church of Christ? On and on the list goes. And that troubled me. It seemed like, why can't we all just get along? Nice 60s, 70 hippie thought. But then there's another scripture in there that God says that he gave differences of administration. And that started ringing true to me. You know, no one church can meet every need that's out there. I don't care if you're Southeast Christian with 20,000 members, you still cannot meet every single need out there. And it occurred to me that God had these different bodies, and our body, our focus has been for 25 years on Team Kid, reaching these children, introducing them to Christ. That's one of our foci. Other churches are very good at some other area of ministry, And so all of these different churches God uses because of their unique interest and capabilities to meet the total need of Christ. And that helped me settle down of why we have different names and we meet under different names. We believe in the same Christ. We worship a little differently. But I do believe that it is God's plan to help us get the total job done. And Campbellsburg Baptist Church, with all our good intentions, with all of our abilities, we're not going to be good at every ministry that needs to be done out there. We have a heart for a particular area. We work towards that. We do that. The Methodist Church has one. The Christian Church has one. And all of us together meet the needs, or come close or better, meet the needs of this community. We need each other. We need the differences. We need the similarities to get the whole job done. So that put that to rest for me. But we need to continue that. There is much work to be done. We talked last night. We had a few of us meet. We watched the movie All Saints. They encouraged me to show it again. You need to see this movie. Those who were here last night can echo that, and I think they will. It was a powerful, moving movie about a church facing struggles and how they came through that. Didn't turn out the way they wanted to, the way they thought it would, but God worked through it and accomplished a tremendous work. And there is work to continue, and we talked about how the culture today, our young people today, are facing challenges that we know nothing about. They're not only coming from homes that are maybe not religious in nature, but are anti-Christian, anti-religious. There's an antagonism. I've talked with youth leaders in the area, and many of our young people are actually dabbling in Satan worship and witchcraft. It's to a level that you can't imagine if you're not in that work. There's a great need out there. There are still homes there that need the love of Christ, and they need mom and dad to follow Christ and be coming to church. And God has called us to reach those homes. He's given us the task of proclaiming that word, and he's built up this body. You are not here by accident. You are here because he has gifted you with something to help us accomplish that task. And as we discover that, as we yield that to God and we link hands and we work together, then God is honored and God adds to the number daily. We want to grow. We can do a lot of marketing. We can do a lot of events. We can do a lot of things to make some of that happen. But the best blessings are when we honor God and he just brings families. We see lives change. We see this baptistry filled up again and lives being transformed. And so the good work is happening. We're a lot further along than where things were a year ago. There's a new optimism. There's a new joy. And we want to continue on in doing that. And we need everyone to join in to the task. We need each and every unique individual because you bring things that no one else does. And as we join hands and as we worship God, as we honor him, as we continue the work, we're going to see blessings from him that we can't imagine. And it'll be such a wonderful experience to know God's working and we didn't actually do it, but we're seeing his miraculous hand in touching lives. And so that's the encouragement today. One, it's an encouragement of thanking you for your involvement, thanking you for your support, thanking you for your work, unseen and seen, but also saying, let's unite together even more. Let's unite together in fellowship and breaking bread together. Unite together in prayer, lifting up these concerns, uniting together to do the physical work that needs to be done, to reach out to others about Christ, to start having a boldness. We become intimidated. We become timid about sharing our faith and even inviting people to church. Well, you have a church here that you can take joy in and want people to come to. And I've been in churches that wasn't always the case. I've been in churches where I didn't know if I wanted friends to come to, that I didn't think they'd be nourished and blessed by the church. But I do believe we have that here at Campbellsburg, and you should be excited to invite your friends to come, because they're going to hear the Word of God. They're going to receive the fellowship of love. They're going to be supported and helped, and it's going to make their life better. So I encourage you to do that. We're going to sing our closing hymn, Lord, Here Am I. And then I'm going to ask you to sit, and I want to share about next week. So let's stand, Julie, come. Let's sing this wonderful hymn of commitment, Lord, Here Am I.